Welcome to Just a Minute. Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four experienced players of the game who are going to compete this week. We welcome back three of the senior members of Just a Minute, which is Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones and Clement Freud, and somebody who's a regular but hasn't been with them quite so long from a different generation of comedians, and that is Paul Merton. Would you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Elaine Wigley, who's going to keep the score, and she'll blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And this particular show is coming from the Pleasance Theatre on the Fringe at the Edinburgh Festival. And I ask our four panellists to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them, and they try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. And let us begin this show with Clement Freud, and a very apt subject for this one, the capital of Scotland. That is the subject, Clement. Speak on it if you can, starting now.
I asked a man on Isla to name me the capital of Scotland. He worked on the Freud distillery, and he said it was Berwick Laddie, and I did not believe him. Went to a reference book and found that, in fact, the capital of Scotland is spelled capital E, capital D, capital I, N-B-U-R-G-H, all in capitals, because...
Daring Nimmo challenge.
Repeat of capital.
No, it's on the card. You can repeat the words on the card.
So
the capital of Scotland. It's all right, you've only been playing the game for 28 years, Derry, but it's, it is difficult to catch up with the rules sometimes. So that was an incorrect challenge, so the person speaking gets a point for that. It was Clement Freud. He keeps the subject. There are 36 seconds left. The capital of Scotland, starting now.
A tunesmith from Edinburgh sang me a song which went, I belong to the capital of Scotland, dear old Glasgow Toon, which outraged the natives who support Rangers, Hibernian, and other football teams.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
I think so, Peter. He really was sort of running out of steam there, wasn't he? So, a correct challenge. A point to you, Peter. 17 seconds left. Tell us something about the capital of Scotland, starting now.
Most friendly and hospitable place. I'd only been here... about 1 hour last night. I was walking along, a lady stepped out of a shop doorway, and we got into conversation, and she ended up by inviting me back to see the place where she worked.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. It was, of course, Peter Jones. Actually, Peter, I have to tell you, I let you go a little beyond 60 seconds because I wanted to know what happened when the lady spoke to you.
Well, as I said, but you didn't hear it. she invited me back to see the place where she worked.
All right. It wasn't a motor car, by any chance, was it?
No car involved.
Right. Peter, you...
I'm sure if you're eager, Nick, he can give you the address of where this happened.
Peter.
Yes.
You have got most points at the end of that round.
Oh, good.
And so you're in the lead. And Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject, souvenirs. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I think they are a bit of a con, souvenirs. They tend to be a souvenir of the shop where you bought it, for example. You buy a plastic bowler hat with Welcome to Skegness written on it. It's not a souvenir of that particular place. It's simply a reminder of the shop where you...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two shops.
There were two shops, yes. Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have a point for that. And you have 44 seconds on souvenirs, starting now.
I think when you travel around, it's frightfully nice to bring back with you souvenirs. I have from Bali a wonderful Vishnu, the god of the Indian mythology, and a Garuda, which is the winged eagle on which he rides. From Peking, I brought back a bottle which is painted on the inside with 100 Chinese characters, and I look at that in my house, and every day I see it, I am taken back to old Cathay, where I have such happy memories. No, souvenirs are very important. I have a brass elephant, which I dug up.
Paul Merton,
Chairman. Repetition of have.
You have. He let the first three go, but got you on the fourth one. So, Paul, a correct challenge, and Souvenirs is back with you. 14 seconds starting now.
I shall be taking home Waverley Station to remind me of the wonderful times I've spent here in Edinburgh. I shall probably put it in my back garden and in some commuters.
Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
I agree, Clement. 3 seconds to go. You've got in just before the whistle. Souvenirs starting now.
I hold my hand in yours, dear.
As I said before, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. It was Clement Freud who's now taken the lead at the end of the round. Peter Jones, your turn to begin. Love letters. Will you tell us something about love letters in just a minute, starting now?
In my youth, I wrote a lot of love letters, but I didn't ever receive quite as many. And I remember one long letter from a girl I wasn't really terribly keen on, and she couldn't even spell the word chauvinist.
Derek Nimmo challenge. There was a hesitation before the chauvinist got out.
It was very slight, wasn't it?
Mm. It was.
It was a very slight buzz in consequence.
Yes.
But enough for me to decide it was a hesitation.
Right.
So Derek comes in on love letters with 46 seconds, starting now.
My darling heart, I adore you. You are the most beautiful creature that I've ever seen in my life. My Venus, my Aphrodite.
Paul Merton challenge.
Four Mys.
Four Mys. Paul, tell us something about love letters. 37 seconds are left, starting now.
I love letters. They're so much better than postcards because you can express your thoughts on a vast expanse of paper. There's no limit to how long this particular letter can be. There can be 10, 15 pages. It doesn't matter.
Clement Freud, you challenged. There was no noise, but your light came on.
Two there can be's.
Yes, there were there can be, there can be. That shattered the audience.
Hey, sirrah, sirrah.
24 seconds, love letters, Clement, starting now.
I received a love letter from a girl who worked on a pick-your-own grouse moor, and it was one of the most enchanting epistles that I have had.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He stopped.
He did. Yeah. 13 seconds, Derek, love letters, starting now.
No.
Clement Freud challenge.
He didn't start.
The audience applause tells me that they enjoyed your challenge, Clement, but it wasn't correct. I'll give you a bonus point because of the challenge that they enjoyed, but Derry gets a point for being interruptive. He keeps the subject, 12 seconds.
My love letters I keep in a suitcase up in my...
Repetition of my. Oh.
Paul, 10 seconds, love letter, starting now.
My darling, when I look into your blue azure eyes, I can see...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
3 eyes.
No, he said, when I look...
No, they're from the last... I was counting them.
He did say I when he was speaking last time. You're quite right, Derek, yes. You've got in very artfully with 3 seconds to go on love letter, starting now.
Her name was Griselda.
Paul Merton.
I just buzzed on the chance that he might say my again. Seeing as his record in the recent past has been fairly my heavy.
It was a good anticipation, but incorrect. So, Derek, you...
Well, how do you know that it was incorrect?
Because it wasn't hesitation. No, it wasn't repetition, because he hadn't...
It was anticipated repetition.
I
stopped him before he said it.
But there's nothing...
So how can you possibly judge whether it's right or wrong?
I can judge, because in this game, it's only if you actually repeat the word, and he hadn't. Anticipation is not part of the rules. So
it should be.
Right, 2.5 seconds. Love letters, Derek.
This starting... glorious girl called Jean Pirrit.
Paul Merton.
Repetition of girl.
Yes, you had a girl before. So, at last, you've done it. 0.5 second ago, you've got it. Paul Merton, love letter starting now.
The letter A.
It's So, an interesting situation. A lot of points were scored in that round. Clement, Freud and Paul Merton are equal, but they're 1 point behind Derek Nimmo, who's now in the lead. And Derek, it is also your turn to begin. And following love letters, we go on to the loving thoughts of Venus. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, I was talking about Venus a few moments ago, and I would have gone on to say, if I hadn't been so rudely interrupted, that she rose from the sea, our Paphos on the coast of Cyprus. They call her Aphrodite, and in fact, they called the island there.
Paul Merton Chance.
Repetition of call.
You called her, and she called.
Oh, he's playing very keenly, isn't he?
Venus, 45 seconds with you, Paul, starting now.
Venus de Milo. I always wondered where the arms went. Perhaps they're in another museum somewhere where just demonstrated in a little glass case just two concrete, not that they're made of that particular substance, but two stone things.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of two. Mm.
Two, yes, there were two twos. Right, Venus, with you, Clement, and 32 seconds available, starting now.
Venus is an anagram of snoove. I didn't know many people knew that. And she was also the goddess of love. I had a godchild whom I took to the theatre, and she said, "There's my best friend. I hate her." I think on the...
Peter Jones challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I think so, Peter.
Well...
After you try to get a laugh on that thing about your godchild.
You don't have to rub it in, do you?
I have to give a little bit of my own back on occasions, because you rub it into me quite frequently, all of you.
Wishful thinking.
I know. Peter Jones, you have 17 seconds with Venus starting now.
The beautiful Venus was made to marry Vulcan, who was a metal worker, I understand, as far as I can remember. Paul would probably be able to tell us more about it. She didn't get on with him terribly well. He was an ugly and rather unattractive person. And anyway, she...
Peter Jones was then speaking as the whistle went. He's moved forward, but he's still trailing the other three or equal just ahead of him. Paul Merton, your turn to begin the subject virtual reality. A rather modern subject, but tell us something about it in just a minute, starting now.
We have before us a virtual reality version of Nicholas Parsons. We can see and hear him, but somehow he's not quite there. It's almost as if you could put your hand through the ghostly shadow that we see before us, and we know we will find a very little backbone or any kind of life as we understand it on this planet. But this doesn't stop him finding regular work on the radio. Alas, television got wind of him quite some time ago, and his appearances there are now restricted to early afternoon or perhaps 4:30 in the morning, just before we get the truck racing from Idaho on Eurosport.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He's not talking about virtual reality. It's a sustained attack against our revered chairman.
Derek, what has come over you? That's the first time you've paid me a compliment in 28 years. So, what is your challenge, actually?
Well, deviation, not talking about virtual
reality. I think whoever challenged, I'd have given it against him, actually. On that. Derek, virtual reality, 17 seconds, starting now.
Apparently, you can go to a virtual reality cafe and you can tune in with this headpiece that you put on to restaurants around the world and talk to people actually sitting within them. But the trouble is, you can't eat any food, because that is reality and not virtual reality. I don't see any point to it myself. I would like...
Well, Derek Nimmo got the points in that round, and he's now gone into the lead just ahead of Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Paul Merton. Peter Jones, your turn to begin. Passing out. Will you tell us something about that, starting now?
Well, you can pass out from a college or academy or school. Sometimes it's associated with fainting. Guardsmen do it. Even educated fleas do it. But anyway, if you want to think of passing out as being an exit...
Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation, I'm afraid.
There was hesitation, yes. I'm sorry.
Yes, there was.
And
there
was a rotten subject. I don't know why I buzzed, actually.
Passing out. 44 seconds left on the subject, starting now.
I remember passing out of number 9 wireless regiment in Cyprus. It was some few years ago. I remember, about 1948. Yes, it was. And I remember then I passed out with tremendous acclaim, particularly from the sergeant major, who was a chum of the colonel. And we won't go into that because these things were not so.
Paul Merton, chum.
Hesitation.
Hesitation, Paul, yes.
Thank goodness.
Passing out is with you. 23 seconds are available, starting now.
I remember when I was about 14 years old and I was travelling on the bus back from school, and several of my friends at that particular establishment were smoking cigarettes, and I was quite young, and we all started inhaling this particular cancerous...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two particulars.
Yes. 10 seconds. Passing out, Clement, starting now.
Passing out of a regiment is probably the most exciting thing that happens in your entire wartime career. I, who was called up to the Highland...
Paul Merton challenge.
Not as exciting as a bomb going off within 5 feet of where you're standing. You'd pass out then, wouldn't you?
Yeah. You actually give me an impossible decision, because in...
how can you make it then?
I'm going to let the audience make the final
judgment. Why are you asking them to make an impossible decision? If you can't do it, what they have? These poor chumps haven't got a clue, have they?
I'm shifting the responsibility. Are you booing him or me? In Clement's... in his... definitely hesitant. Colloquially speaking, Clement may think that was one of the... Right, I'm going to put it to the audience. If you agree with Paul Merton's challenge... I'm getting a lot of points, you realise that, don't you?
It seems to be impossible to judge and impossible to say.
I know. If you agree with Paul Merton's challenge, you cheer for him, and if you disagree, you boo for Clement Freud, and you all do it together now.
Boo.
You've actually conned this audience before we play. Right, you have the subject, Paul. 3 seconds. Passing out, starting now.
Suddenly there was a blow on the back of my head and I fell...
Paul Merton and Clement Freud are equal, one behind Derek Nimmo, who's in the lead, and Peter Jones is only just behind all of them. And Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, Bobby. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Being in the fair city of Edinburgh, or Dunedin, to give it its ancient name, one immediately thinks of Greyfriars Bobby, that wonderfully loyal terrier who, after his master had died, spent 14 years, ladies and gentlemen, waiting by the grave, and he's now commemorated with a glorious fountain in Candlemaker's Row. I think that is one of the most charming tales that I've ever heard. My teddy bear was called Bobby. He's now at the Stratford-on-Avon Museum for that said animals. Very nice, much loved, a seat bear with nice teddy... Oh, I said it earlier.
Clement Freud challenge.
I was agreeing with him.
He was agreeing with the fact he said, Teddy, right, Clement, 24 seconds on Bobby, starting now.
Bobby is a name given to London policemen because of Robert Peel, who invented the whole crooked race when he was the Victorian Home Secretary. I'm not a tremendous believer in calling...
Peter Jones challenge.
Why don't you just press your button as I start speaking?
Because actually, I'll be truthful, Clement, you were hesitating.
I speak slowly.
That was a definite hesitation. And it was Peter Jones who got in first. 8 seconds on Bobby, Peter, starting now.
Bobby Jones was a famous golfer when I was a boy. And then there's Bobby Short, who is one of the greatest evening entertainers.
Jones was then speaking as the whistle went. He's moved forward. They're all almost equal. But Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo are exactly equal in the lead. And Clement, your turn to begin. The subject, shuffling. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Shuffling is very nearly an anagram of flushing. And if you were Welsh and put things with a double F, it would be. Shuffling is something which one does to packs of cards and cabinets, especially if they are unsatisfactory. Ministers...
Paul Merton, challenge.
Hesitation.
You definitely said
I stop at the end of a sentence.
But you not only stop...
It's not the stopping, it's the starting again.
And if you put an actual in between, it is more than definite hesitation.
Draws attention to it, doesn't it, really?
2 seconds on shuffling with you, Paul, starting now.
Well, it can be seen as an indication of guilt if a person shuffles from one foot to another. I believe that there are many...
Another hesitation. 33 seconds, Peter. Will you shuffle for us, starting now?
Well, this method of propulsion is famed in song and story in the famous number Shuffle Off to Buffalo. The why one would want to go to Buffalo in
Jerry Nimmo Chan.
Well, I thought it was a kind of hesitation, tongue-tied, sort of funny noise.
Just ignore say hesitation, that'll be enough.
But strangely enough... He said hesitation, but though it may have got a sort of glottal stop in the middle of the word, he didn't actually hesitate in speech, so I don't think I can grant it.
Oh, well, fine.
21 seconds, still shuffling with you, Peter, starting now.
I'm just worried about this glottal stop. I don't know. Perhaps it's my Arab upbringing. I don't know.
Derek, yes.
Tradition of I don't know.
I don't know, you repeated, I'm afraid.
Oh, yes, I do.
Yes, 13
well,
seconds.
I don't know.
Derek. Shuffling, starting now.
See them shuffling along. Isn't that an exciting thought? I'd love to go out to Buffalo and see them shuffle in.
Paul Merton,
challenge. Repetition of see them.
I'd love to go out, yes. Isn't that lovely, seeing them shuffling along, go out to Buffalo and see them shuffling along. You...
It is almost half a sentence being repeated.
The reason I have to do it, because I must explain it, and this audience will bear me out, they look at me as if to bluff me out and say, you cannot.
We just look at you with contempt.
It is the same.
Why
man
do you want to applaud insults all the time?
This is the same man who a moment ago talked about our revered chairman.
I know. It's amazing
you
how
converted
you can change. There's such a thing as fickleness, and it's been demonstrated. And there are 6 seconds for Paul Merton to tell us something about shuffling, starting now.
See them shuffling along, ditto. I love that actual experience, because once they get...
So Paul Merton got that extra point, and he's now taken the lead at the end of that round, and it's his turn to begin. Paul, the subject, ram raiding. Will you tell us something about ram raiding, starting now?
Well, this was a disgusting habit. What people do is they ram sheep through shop doorways, smash the windows and run off with hi-fi equipment. And the poor animal's lying there with blood running out of its head. Police come along, can you give us an adequate description of the people that rammed you into this? I've no idea, it all happened so quickly, officer, and that's not the half of it, because it's Friday night and you know what happens round here. So they have to go down an identification parade. Was this the particular villain who got hold of you that night? Well, I can't really say, because he came up for me, bombed behind, and he had a stocking over his head, and he was putting on some kind of funny accent, so I can't be entirely sure that it was this felon in question. At this point, the authorities will say to the sheep, you must understand that this practice must cease. And so the ram would go around in disguise, probably a policewoman with a fur coat over her back, we'll walk around the shopping centres late in the particular evening trying to see if these villains who I've mentioned before, I know what's going on and I don't care. Also, if you go to Wales, there's a different kind of ram raiding that goes on. This is called dating. And what happens there is that if you find a suitable hill, you place this animal against the slope of the meadow that you find, which could always lover's lane is a very good bet. And you take a torch, a pair of rubber gloves, and a bucket. Now, what you do with the rubber gloves is, well, I can't really go in.
So Paul Merton started with the subject, and he kept going, and with a little connivance from the chairman, who actually blew the whistle on that occasion after 1 minute, 30 seconds. Because we were enjoying it so much, the audience were enjoying it. So, Paul, you not only get a point for speaking when the whistle went, you get another point for not being interrupted, and I'm going to give you a bonus point for going for another 30 seconds over the time. And so you've increased your lead at the end of that round. And we're moving into the last round. Oh, dear. It's still very close, though Paul's just in the lead. And oh. Yes, I know, all good things have to come to an end. But remember, you did get in free. Peter Jones, moving into the last round. It's still anybody's game, and it's your turn to begin. The subject pauses. We've had a few of those in this game. Will you talk about them starting now?
Well, pauses should be the lifeblood of conversation and dialogue. Harold Pinter has made a fortune out of them. Now, I think it would be nice if we could have a game where one paused for a minute without actually speaking. I should probably win the game every week because these loquacious people around me...
What? Clement Freud challenged.
It's another game.
Did you repeat the word game, I'm afraid?
Oh, I see. Yes. Game.
So, Clement, you have the subject of pauses. You have 44 seconds starting now.
I'd quite like to have a game where you hesitate for a minute, which would be much more fun. Even repeating yourself for 60 seconds might be not unamusing. In Germany, the word Pause...
Paul Merton Jones.
Hesitation?
I think so, yes. Yes.
Yeah. Or not, I mean... I'm not married to it, you know.
If I've given the other debatable hesitations, I must give that one as well. It's only fair. So, Paul, 30 seconds. Pause is starting now.
What, just a minute.
Yes.
Fair.
I must be consistent, and that is being fair. It's being fair to all the players.
You suffer from delusions of adequacy.
Yes, and I'm used to getting insults from all the panel, but now I've got the fair share. Everyone has insulted me except Peter Jones. But let's carry on
Peter.
Now.
Right.
Peter,
I don't think he knows who you are, Nicholas.
You're going for the record, are you? Where did you get that sweater, by the way? Colour blind or us or something? I don't know. Seconds are still available for you, Paul, to take over. Pauses starting now.
Pauses is what puppies have at the end of their feetings. And you see the footprints they leave in wet concrete or damp grass or anywhere that's capable of sustaining an impression of what they have at the end of their body at each corner.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
At the end of.
At the end of, yes. Peter, you've got in with 13 seconds. Pauses starting now.
Well, they are quite interesting.
Derek Nimmo,
transition of well.
I think you said well last time.
You
well
think too. I did? Ah.
No, it's not often.
I know, I often do.
You did, actually, Peter.
I did.
Yes. 12 seconds. Derek, pauses starting now.
It would really be very nice to be able to have a pause now and have a glass of cold water.
Clement Freud challenge.
Two halves.
Pause now and have a glass of water.
Yes, that's right.
Why does that make it? Two halves.
Well, it's repetition of have. You see, that's another rule of the game, Derek.
The loss of short-term memory ruins it.
Clement, you have 6 seconds on pauses starting now.
Four paws per dog is just about the right number, I believe.
Freud was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so. At the end of the contest, it is extraordinary even. I said the contribution is what matters, and it's interesting that Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo are all almost equal in second place, but just only 3 points ahead was Paul Merton, so we'll say he's the victor this week. It only remains for me to say, on behalf of our four outstanding panellists on Just a Minute, Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones, and also to thank this audience here at the Pleasance on the Fringe in Edinburgh for the warmth of their response, and also Elaine Wigley for the way she blew her whistle and kept the score, Ian Messiter for thinking of the game, which we all enjoy playing so much, and above all, thank our producer Anne Jobson. From them and from our audience here, we do hope you've enjoyed the show, and tune in again next time we take the air to play Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye! Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome our four exciting personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We have two of our long-standing players of the game, that is Peter Jones and Clement Freud, and we also have two of our more recent regular players of the game, Paul Merton and Kit Hesketh-Harvey. Would you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Elaine Wigley, who is going to keep the score and blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And this particular recording of Just a Minute is coming from the new radio theatre, which is in the bowels of Broadcasting House. I'm going, as usual, ask our four players to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. Let us begin the show this week with Clement Freud, and the subject, Clement, is charisma. Well, this show, there's been plenty of charisma shown throughout every series. But talk on it if you can, Clement, starting now.
Charisma is a sort of journeyman halo when it's vested in people who are not saints. P.T. Barnum was extraordinarily charismatic. He was once told that the man who was fired from the cannon in his circus was dead, and said, "That is sad, it will be hard to find a man of the same caliber." Tommy Docherty, the football manager, I think has charisma like few other people. He is the inventor of the phrase, "Do unto others and run like hell." Also, a friend in need is a pain in the arse. But Nicholas Parsons, if you look at him carefully, you will notice a sort of void where charisma comes up. All the other elements are there, his blazer, his tie, hair, which seems to have gone more profuse over the months.
And Peter Jones has challenged.
He's not really talking about charisma, he's talking about lack of charisma.
Yes, it's a correct challenge, Peter, but... Unfortunately, you've emphasised the fact that he was applying it to me, and so... But as it's a correct challenge, you have a point for that, and you take over the subject. But Clement did keep going for 58 seconds, which is quite an achievement. So, Peter, 2 seconds on charisma, starting now.
If you haven't got it, you'll never get it.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Peter Jones, so he's naturally in the lead at the end of that round. Paul Merton, will you take the next round? What a carry-on. An expression, a phrase, but a subject on which we'd like you to talk, starting now.
When Uncle George built a spaceship in his back garden, all the neighbours said, "What a carry-on! The man's insane. He attempts to get to the moon in nothing more than a giant milk bottle with a firework shoved into the top. He's strapped an armchair to the side of it. He's going to light the blue touch paper and not retire, but instead shoot up into the stars." So the police were called and they said, "Well, it's not a matter for us, really. This man is seriously ill in a psychiatric way." They didn't quite phrase it like that. They said, "He's balmy, get the doctor." So the medical man arrived and he examined the gentleman.
Clement Freud challenged.
There seemed to be a hesitation.
There was a definite So Clement.
Oh, what rubbish.
You did actually say
Possibly.
Is, yeah.
But I didn't hesitate when I said it.
No, you didn't hesitate when you said it. Which is a new subtle way of playing Just a Minute. In other words, you kept speaking, but you did say and as is not in the Oxford English Dictionary, we interpret that as hesitation. Clement challenged. He has a point. He takes the subject. And there are 22 seconds left. What a carry-on, Clement, starting now.
In the theatre, a walk-on who is unable to perambulate onto the stage and is brought
Paul Merton challenge.
Well, I know I was going to say for repetition, but it was on, and it's what a carry-on.
Yes, you can repeat.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, Clement, incorrect challenge. You get a point for that. You keep the subject 14 seconds. What a carry-on, starting now.
Is known by some members of the audience as a carry-on by virtue of the fact that he or she is unable to fly, use a trapeze, or be brought in any other manner or custom towards the scenario.
When the whistle was blown then by Lane, it told us that 60 seconds was up, and Clement Freud was speaking on that occasion, so he gained that extra point for doing so, and he's now taken the lead. Let us move to Peter Jones to begin. Peter, the subject is smut. Little of it in just a minute, I'm sure, but that's the subject to talk about or talk on starting now.
It's a lovely word, isn't it? And it really describes a sort of cleaned-up version of filth. And I think it's a poor substitute, really. I remember my first encounter with it was a postcard which I saw in a newsagent's window, which depicted a vicar addressing his audience at a village concert, and he was saying, "And Miss Stingo will now sing when I am in my little bed accompanied by the curate." And the curate was in the background.
Paul Merton challenge.
Sadly, repetition of curates.
Yes, oh, you yes. had too many curates in that bed, I'm
yes.
afraid.
Well, you've got the gist of it anyway.
Yes. You were making it more smutty than it really was.
Yeah, I was only nine.
Yeah, but you still recognise the smut. Paul Merton, you have 27 seconds smut. Starting now.
The smuttiest thing I've seen in the last 30 years is Nicholas Parsons in the Rocky Horror Show. It is a performance riddled with filth. He walks onto the stage and, by his own confession, roundly abuses the audience for turning up in the first place, and then performs a rather disgusting exotic cabaret with various selected vegetables. The finale of his act, if you can call it such a thing, is where he inserts a marrow...
That is what we call being saved by the whistle, actually. We won't take it any further, except to say that Paul Merton was speaking when the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so, and he's now in second place, just behind Clement Freud. And Kit Hesketh-Harvey, your turn to begin. Spin doctors. Can you talk about them starting now?
Well, there are many definitions, perhaps, of the term spin doctors. One thinks of the whirling dervishes of the Mohammedans who vowed poverty and chastity and in that climate simply had to spin to make any fun out of life. There are the NHS junior doctors who are whipped by Mrs. Bottomley or her successor into a fantastic, towering frenzy of performance, 256 hours a week, some of them, unable, oh Lord, heavens.
Clement Freud. Yes, I recognised it.
He
I
was
think we
spun.
All did. 34 seconds. Spin doctors, starting now.
I think the spin doctor that most of us have closest to our hearts is W.G. Grace, who played cricket for 50 years of the 80 that he lived, who captained the gentlemen of England at Lord's when he was well into past middle age, and who took 2,800 first-class wickets, mostly at the cricket ground that Mr. Lord had in St. John's Wood, but also...
Peter Jones is challenged.
Your repetition.
No, it was too many wickets.
Oh, too
it?
Many wickets, was it?
Yes. Well, that's right.
I thought he repeated laws.
W.G. Grace was noted spin for his batting, doctor. Not for his spin bowling.
Was he?
Yes.
He took... he took 2,800...
Well, God knows you were there. You should know.
Clement, there with you. You have an incorrect challenge, so you keep... at a point, keep the subject. 6 seconds. Spin doctors starting now.
Leg breaks, off got us, but especially the ball that went with the arm.
Clement Freud, speaking as the whistle went, has increased his lead at the end of the round, and it has come round for him to speak. And the subject you're taking now is bubble and squeak. Can you talk on bubble and squeak? In fact, I think you should tell us how we make the best bubble and squeak. 60 seconds, starting now.
Bubbles.
Paul Merton.
Hesitation.
Don't encourage him, for goodness sake. If we were to challenge as rapidly as that all the time, Paul, actually it was only 2/3 of a second, so I don't think I could allow it. Clement has another point. Bubble and Squeak, Clement, starting now.
Bubble and Squeak is a sort of...
That's what often happens.
That was longer than 2/3 of a second.
But Kit Hesketh-Harvey pressed his mouth the first, I'm afraid. Kit, Bubble and Squeak, with you, starting now.
Of course, it's absolutely delicious and terribly unfashionable nowadays because of its high cholesterol content, but for about 2/3 of a second...
Paul Merton, challenge.
Cholesterol?
It's a slight deviation from the word as we understand it. So... Paul, you've gone incorrectly there. 50 seconds on Bubble and Squeak, starting now.
Billy Bubble and Sammy Squeak were one of the most popular double acts in the 1930s. Between them, they took over 2,800 wickets, and that was while they were playing the Chiswick Empire. They were a fantastic combination, and people used to rush the theatre every night to see what Bubble and Squeak were up to in their crazy antics. In many ways, they were a kind of version of Kit and the Widow, except 50 years before...
Clement and Freud, challenge.
Two kits.
Kit and the Widow and the Kit. You repeated the word
was
kit.
Kit
well, I heard it, didn't you?
Wickets before, but not kit.
Wicket.
You do two kits. Yes, there's one person in the audience heard it. Yes, yes, we have to be very sharp here.
So one person in the audience has heard it out of 400. And we don't know who that person
other
is. They might be mentally unbalanced.
The other 400, you've completely conned over to you as your fans and followings. You've usurped them.
I've never usurped anybody in my life. How dare you?
No, you did actually repeat the word kit. And Clement Freud heard
it. You're making it up.
When you listen to this show, when it's...
I will, don't worry about that. And so will my lawyer.
I certainly didn't hear it, though I must admit I wasn't listening very hard.
Now, look, this punch-up is a free-for-all. If anybody else wants to join in, they can. I'm going to stand by what I heard, and Clement, you have a correct challenge. 27 seconds, Bubble and Squeak starting now.
Bubble and Squeak is a mixture of cabbage and potato. And the former of these can be Savoy or any other kind. The latter, King Edward's, White's, Mary's Piper. It is unimportant. The crucial thing...
Kit Hesketh-Harvey.
More than 2/3 of a second, I'm afraid.
Yes, yes, it was. It was a hesitation. 12 seconds for you, Kit, on Bubble and Squeak, starting now.
I once had two hamsters called Bubble and Squeak. They were absolutely enchanting and lived entirely on Mary's Piper and Desiree. But what they missed...
Hesitation.
Yes, Peter. Bubble and Squeak's with you now, and you have 4 seconds starting now.
I must say, I think it's a disgrace that this subject should be given to one of the world famous...
Peter Jones, speaking as the whistle, Wayne gained that extra point. He's equal in second place of Paul Merton. Clement Freud is still in the lead. Kit Hesketh-Harvey is only 1 point behind those in second place. Paul, your turn to begin. The subject, Martians. Will you tell us something about them in just a minute, starting now?
In 1938, Orson Welles produced a radio adaptation of the H.G. Wells story, The War of the Worlds. And by a simple device of pretending that this dramatisation was in fact a real news programme, he managed to persuade millions of Americans into thinking that the Martians had landed in New Jersey. And there was all kinds of terrible panic going on, and apparently, according to the papers next day, several people attempted to commit suicide, and one woman spread herself naked on the hill and said, "I'm ready, take me now." But apparently she did this every Friday. Don't tell me, repetition of Kit.
Kit Hesketh-Harvey, what was your challenge? What?
Two apparentlys? I think there were
two apparentlys, I'm afraid, yes. 23 seconds on Martians with you, Kit Hesketh-Harvey, starting now.
Broadly speaking, I suppose Martians are people who come from Mars. I think of Marianne Faithful at times like this and think what a...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two thinks.
You were thinking too much, I'm afraid. Which is useful in this game, but not to repeat the word. 16 seconds, Clement. Martians, starting now.
It is an alternative plural of the Christian name Marcia, as in Forkender. You could say I was walking down the street with several Martians.
It's
the sea, surely, wouldn't it?
Only if you have a beach.
Aaron Bishop.
It was a good try, but I think I'll give the benefit of the doubt to Clement and tell him he has 5 seconds on Martian starting now.
If you come from Mars, you are...
Peter Jones challenge.
Hesitation.
Indeed, Peter, and you got in a game with only 1 second to go on the subject. On Martian starting now.
If they come here, don't let them in.
So Peter Jones has moved into second place ahead of the other two, and Clement Freud's still in the lead. And Peter, it's your turn to begin. The subject is revelations. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute?
Well, revelations are usually associated with exposures of some kind. And every hero that we ever had when we were children has been exposed in one way or another. And I'm waiting for Mother Teresa, for instance, to be named as the lover of some...
Paul Merton challenge.
Hesitation,
well, yes. It was reasonable to hesitate over such a delicate subject.
Especially with Mother Teresa in mind.
Exactly.
So, Paul, you've got him with 40 seconds on revelation, starting now.
I had a most extraordinary revelation the other day when I heard that Peter Jones in the 1940s worked in a Hungarian circus under the name of Betty Allsop. And he worked as a knife thrower's assistant. Every night, as Queen Carl...
Get Hesketh-Harvey.
I'm afraid he hesitated. I was longing to know what was coming.
I know.
Yeah, so was I.
It didn't come out, though. Right, 25 seconds. Revelations from you, Kit, starting now.
Of course, in theological terminology, the revelations are of St. John the Divine, the last book of the New Testament, and he is no relation to Hugh Grant's friend, of course, who works on Sunset Boulevard, nor...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of course.
What a pity, because I think he was getting quite interesting then. 14 seconds on Revelations with you, Clement, starting now.
Revelations is not only the last book of the Bible, but also the name of rather a good lot of suitcases.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of also.
Yes, it's a tough challenge, but it's correct. So, 7 seconds on Revelations with you, Paul, starting now.
Well, my one revelation that I wish to produce here tonight...
Kit Hesketh.
The subject's Revelations rather than Revelation.
Yep.
Yes.
And if there's only one...
Well, it doesn't matter. He hasn't got going. He can say, well, he's talking about revelations. He can start off by saying, my one revelation.
And then two revelation,
yeah.
And so on.
Up to 33 and a third revelations a minute.
No, I think he was perfectly correct. You've got to establish what you're going to talk about, and he was talking about his one revelation, which is within the subject. 3 seconds with you, Paul, starting now.
Is this, many years ago, I...
So Clement Freud is still in the lead. Paul Merton is now in second place, then Kit Hesketh-Harvey, then Peter Jones. Only 1 point separates them all. And Kit Hesketh-Harvey, it's your turn to begin. And the subject is alchemy. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
It was the Elizabethan sage John Dee who was the aegis of his age. I think he was an astronomer, a necromancer. He travelled in the Far East and brought back delicate instruments with which he could measure the routes to the Far East and the Virgin Queen for such he was.
Peter Jones challenge.
A repetition of the Far East.
You had too many Far Easts.
Oh, Lord, I was getting so keen on the Virgin Queen.
Peter, 44 seconds on alchemy, starting now.
Well, it was just these crazy people who thought they could turn lead into gold and make a great deal of money. And they never succeeded, as anybody with any sense would have known they couldn't. And that's about all I know about it, really.
And you came to a full stop.
Yes.
So that's hesitation.
And they should have done the same.
Kit Hesketh-Harvey, 29 seconds on alchemy, starting now.
Its point is the law of supply and demand. If everything is made of gold, then nothing is worth anything, really, is it? Or the Ionian fallacy. However, it became the subject of a play by Ben Jonson at the beginning of the next century, in which the eponymous...
Paul Merton challenged.
Yes. Now, I think I know what you mean when you said beginning of the next century. You meant from the... passage of time you'd meant before.
That was generally what
I meant. Yeah, but I'd heard next century, so it sounded like this play had yet to be written. But then I realised that he had been talking... are you with me?
I don't think anybody's with you, actually.
Repetition.
I think you've gone on one of your flights of fantasy and explaining what your challenge was.
You can say that to me, wearing that jacket.
No.
It looks like a barcode. There, I saved it for the show.
I know. You've got to laugh the first time and a round of applause the second. Kit, I disagree with the challenge.
Well, it wasn't a challenge, it was nonsense. We all know that. No.
So you still have alchemy and you have 17 seconds to continue starting now.
In which Sir Epicure Mammon, I believe his name is, duped by an alchemist into believing that he can reach the Philosopher's Stone. Tribulation Hulk.
Clement Freud challenged.
Did I?
Yes.
It was not a valid challenge.
No.
Shall we put it to the audience? No.
I know what the result would be, that Kit has another point in 8 seconds on alchemy starting now.
In trying to seduce his lovely daughter, Dame Pliant, who is being beaten from pillar to post by these wicked, terrible men.
Well, that is the first time in this show that anybody started with the subject and, in spite of interruption, still had it when the whistle went. Oh. Kit Hesketh-Harvey, you had a point for speaking when the whistle went, a number of points in the round, and you are now only 1 point behind our leader, who is still Clement Freud. And, Clement, it is your turn to begin, and the subject is Skulduggery.
Rigor mortis?
It was probably a bit of rigor mortis on my part because I forgot to say starting now. So I've recovered because I'm just about to have a little drink of water to clear my throat. But Clement Freud, it's Skulduggery starting now.
Skulduggery is the past participle of Skulduggery. If you were to go into a country churchyard late one night with a spade or a shovel and disturb the earth in order to see what is inside the graves, and you came across the skull of someone, that would be skulduggery. If you did it last week, it would be skulduggery. I do hope I make myself clear on this. It's also a word given to doing things nastily in an underhand manner, possibly illegally, or even in such a way as the justice of the peace might call the matter to his attention and send you before the courts of law in order to serve some time at the public taxpayers' expense, which seems to do very little good to the actual felons who commit such crimes. Skulduggery, it's a word which...
Oh! He was challenged as the whistle went, but we don't allow that because he went so magnificently for 60 seconds. So on that occasion, we not only give him a point for speaking as the whistle went, but he gains a bonus point for not being interrupted. Well done, Clement, and your applause showed how much they appreciated it. And you've increased your lead at the end of the round, and it is Paul Merton's turn to begin. The subject is playing the goat. 60 seconds. Stop. I don't know why they laugh at you, Paul. I don't know what image you've established in this audience's mind, but would you talk on the subject starting now?
First, you must tune your goat adequately. You must blow into its ear, and with a bit of luck, a noise will emerge from its mouth. After a little bit of fingering that you have to do down the middle of its back, it's possible to play such marvellous melodies as Lullaby of Broadway, It's a Long Way to Tipperary, and A Nightingale Sang in Berkeley Square. There is an orchestra in Munich which consists entirely of Germans playing goats. They specialise in the works of Beethoven, the Eroica Symphony No. 3, for those who are aware of that great master's work. It's a particularly strong item, and the locals come to hear the billy goats' marvellous interpretation of these chromatic scales building up to a crescendo at the end of the third movement, where flannels have to come onto the stage to wipe the goats down.
A resounding round of applause. Well done, Paul.
It's a true story.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the audience realised that, and that's why they were laughing so much. Peter Jones, it's your turn to begin. The subject is liberty. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Well, it's a very nice shop in Regent Street, and I often enjoy going there. They have excellent sales, which go on for about 11 and a half months out of the 12, and they don't have very good bargains, but they do have interesting materials from different parts of the world, particularly in the basement. And I've bought one or two things from there, two chairs, one or two vases.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of two.
Yes, one or two. One or two.
Two, yes.
Yes. 35 seconds are available for you on liberty, Paul, starting now.
What a wonderful country we live in. We have liberty. We can come to the radio theatre and listen to Just a Minute. We can point at the Prime Minister in the street and shout out, "You're useless," and nobody can arrest us for this. This is perfectly normal behaviour in this great British country of ours. I don't know why I particularly call it that, but of course it is more or less the United Kingdom. And if
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of country.
Yes. 14 seconds. Liberty with you, Clement, starting now.
The Statue of Liberty, depicting a woman with a left arm raised and a funny sort of haircut, is standing in New York, and should you arrive by boat, may be the very first thing you see.
So, Clement Freud was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He has increased his lead. He's 3 points ahead of Paul Merton in second place, four ahead of Kit Hesketh-Harvey, and five ahead of Peter Jones, and we're moving into the last round. It could, by a flash in the pan, be anybody's, but let's see what happens as we start the next round with Kit Hesketh-Harvey. Expostulate. That is the subject on the card. Can you expostulate on that subject, starting now?
It's not a subject one likes to do very much in front of a paying audience, or even a non-paying such.
Yes.
It's non-paying hyphenated, I think.
I think we take the word paying. So, Paul, I agree with the challenge. 54 seconds, expostulate, starting now.
My next-door neighbour was well known to the police all over Britain for expostulating late at night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, when the rest of us were trying to get to sleep. And there would be this unholy smell coming from the inside of his house and the sound of goats being tuned up for some god-awful satanic version of Wagner's Ride of the Valkyries. It was a nightmare to be living next to this man. So one day I popped round to his abode, I knocked firmly on the door and I said, "Look, I speak for everybody in this street. We're sick to death of your expostulations, which are all over the pavement, and some of them blame the Labradors, but I know it's you." He stood up to his full height and he expostulated right in my face, and I was covered from head to foot in this expostulation liquid that was...
Well, a fine example of expostulation, and kept him going until the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so, and in spite of all that energy expended, Paul Merton finished up in second place, just ahead of Kit Hesketh-Harvey and Peter Jones, but 2 points ahead of Paul was Clement Freud. So we say he is the winner this week. Congratulations. It remains for me to thank our four talented players of the game, which is Clement Freud, Paul Merton, Peter Jones and Kit Hesketh-Harvey. Also, Elaine Wigley for keeping the score. And Ian Messiter, of course, who created the game and thought up the subjects. And our producer, Anne Jobson, for producing and directing the show. So from all of them and from me, Nicholas Parsons, this is goodbye. Hope you enjoyed the show and we'll be tuned in next time we take to the air to play Just a Minute. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four talented players who are this week going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back two regular players of the game, Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones, and on the other side of the stage, someone who's played the game many times before and someone who has never played it before. That is Tony Hawks and Fred MacAuley. Would you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Liz Trott, who is going to keep the score and blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I'm going to ask our panellists to speak in turn, if they can, on a subject that I will give them. And they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. This particular recording of Just a Minute is coming from the delightful Civic Hall in Ayr. And Derek Nimmo, who's going to begin the show, has got a very apt subject to start with. It is Ayr. Derek, will you tell us something about Ayr in 60 seconds, starting now?
Appropriately enough, I came to Ayr by Ayr today. I started out at 1600 hours yesterday, Saturday, in Mexico City, and then flew across the Gulf of Mexico to...
Tony Hawk's a challenge.
Repetition of Mexico.
Yes, you've had two Mexicos.
Well, I was there quite a long time.
Tony, you have a correct challenge of repetition, and you take over the subject. You get a point for that. You have 48 seconds starting now.
Ayr is a simply wonderful place. That's why there are so many songs written about it, like Sometimes All I Need Is the Ayr That I Breathe, or We're Walking in the Ayr. These are marvellous tributes to a place which has pleased me for many years. I've driven here on... hold on.
Yes, all that ingratiating twaddle.
Yeah, I can only lie.
You deserve to pause. So,
sorry,
Peter,
yes.
You got in first. Hesitation, you have the subject. 29 seconds are left for Ayr, starting now.
Well, I've only been here for 2 hours, so I really think it should be the chairman who should be talking to you about Ayr and Scotland generally, because he is a native. He was brought up in Glasgow, where he was an engineer. One of his previous...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation, I'm afraid, yes, because I was lying to hear about my life story. So, Derek Nimmo, you have got in with the correct challenge. You get a point for that. You take over the subject or take it back. 15 seconds are left, starting now.
I had many happy holidays at Prestwick in my youth. I used to travel here. My aunt and uncle came from Glasgow, Clarkston, and on we came to this glorious beach and winds as you would not believe. It used to howl across, and I've got pictures of myself, a little tiny short... set.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle is blown gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Derek Nimmo. Peter Jones, will you take the next round? The subject, mooning. Take it any way you wish. Talk on it if you can. 60 seconds are available, starting now.
Well, when I was a boy, my father used to accuse me of mooning when I was just sort of sitting around doing nothing and not really being a contributor to the family life. But nowadays, mooning means taking down your trousers and exposing your buttocks to someone you don't like. And it can be done from a motor car or coach. And I've never had it actually done to me. Though...
Derek, no more challenge.
It isn't done.
What a pity, I was enjoying it. Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have the subject, which is mooning, and you have 33 seconds starting now.
What I really want to know is, if you only show one buttock, is it called half mooning? I find it very unpleasant. I feel gay along the streets these days, and I have seen people in motor cars, and I look across and I think, what a funny-looking woman that is. And I realize it's not a lady at all. It's these other dimensional things, these rare ends that are being so displayed. I can't see the point of it. Can you imagine in the city of Ayr, on the golf course at Troon, or on the beach at Prestwick, having buttocks displayed?
Tony Hawk's challenge.
Repetition of buttocks?
Yes, we had buttocks before,
yes,
I'm afraid. You can't have too many buttocks in Just a Minute. But Tony, you've cleverly got in with 2 seconds to go on the subject of mooning. Another point to you, and you start now.
Sometimes you can see builders mooning by accident.
Tony Hawks was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so. And Tony, it is your turn to begin. The subject is stretching my legs. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
I am 6 foot 2.5 inches tall already.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Boasting.
Especially as he added the already. Does he expect to go taller? Peter, he didn't commit any of the crimes of just a minute, so what we do is we love the challenge, we give you a bonus point for the interruption, but of course, as he was interrupted, Tony Hawks gets a point for that. He keeps the subject, stretching my legs, 57 seconds left, starting now.
Therefore, I have no need for stretching my legs any taller and I wouldn't be able to fit through doorways. My brother, however, paid to have his legs stretched but could only afford to have one done, and now he walks in circles whenever he goes anywhere. If I was going to stretch my legs, what better place than the air? I could walk across Victoria Bridge, down along the River Aire, towards the free parking at Mill Bray. Yes, how important it is to stretching your legs in a place where you... Oh, I'm just talking rubbish now.
I know. I know, but you've done your homework. Derek, you challenge first.
Well, yes. He stopped, didn't he?
Yes, he did. Hesitation. 26 seconds. A point to you. And the subject, stretching my legs, Derek, starting now.
I think stretching my legs is often used as a euphemism for going outside and walking around and perhaps having a little penny spending. I don't know. Perhaps I'm wrong about that. But actually, during the Inquisition, they had very ingenious machines for stretching one's legs. They had great bars which they would wind downwards until actually the people's bodies broke into... It's quite...
Fred MacAuley, how nice to hear from you, Fred. And can I say, before you give us your challenge, you very cleverly got in with only 1 second to go. What is your challenge? Yes, I would grant it, Fred, because it's the first time you've played the game, and you have 1 second. Stretching my legs, starting now.
Stretching my legs is an...
So, Fred MacAuley was then speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so, and he's in second place, equal with Peter Jones at the end of the round, and it's his turn to begin. The subject is stress. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Well, there's probably no greater stress put on anyone than to appear for the first time on a show like Just a Minute and to try and speak for that length of time on a subject like the one that you've just given me. Medical people in the audience will know that there are certain features of stress that are apparent in casualty wards. These are known as stress fractures, where people can't handle the stress and they end up banging their wrist or their shin on an item of office equipment till it breaks. And I can well understand why they do that. Oh, dearie me, I can't handle this.
Tony Hawks, your challenge.
Repetition of woo. Yeah.
You did, ooh, a bit too much, I'm afraid, Fred, but it was very good. 24 seconds with you, Tony, on stress, starting now.
I cannot stress enough how well Fred MacAuley did there with his virgin speech on this programme. Most people would crumble under the stress, but he rose to the occasion like a true champion, like a Scot, and like...
Peter Jones challenge.
Like, too many likes.
Too many likes, yes. Peter, another point, and the subject, 12 seconds, stress, starting now.
One is always hearing about highly paid executives suffering from stress when they get about £500,000 a year. And yet, people who are really under stress, like window cleaners, don't get nearly as much. And surely... Yes.
Peter Jones is then speaking as the whistle went, gained the extra point for doing so. It's your turn to begin. Brass. Tell us something about that in this game, starting now.
It's a very attractive metal. I think it compares favourably with gold when it's used decoratively. And, of course, it is a combination of bronze and zinc. No, copper, I think, and the aforementioned metal, which can be tin.
Derek, you try.
Metal.
Metal, yes. 45 seconds are available for you. Brass, Derek, starting now.
Top-ranking officers since the time of the Boer War have been called brass for reasons of the amount of gold that was on their hats, which was sometimes called scrambled egg. Did you know? That's frightfully interesting, isn't it? Anyway, from those times, that is why brass has been used in that particular way. Well, I can also think
Peter
of...
Peter Jones, as Charles.
You said there was gold on the top of there. Well,
that's why they call it top brass.
Why didn't they say it's top gold?
Well, they didn't. They said top brass.
Well, it doesn't make sense. Of course it doesn't.
A lot of the things which are said in just a minute don't make sense.
Well, yeah.
If we all had to talk sense all the time in this game, I think it would grind to a shuddering halt on occasions. Derek, I disagree with the challenge. So you keep the subject and you have 29 seconds left for brass, starting now.
Bold as brass, they say sometimes, don't they? Have you heard them? They shout out, he is as... Well, as I just said now, as brass. You have to be very careful not to repeat things. One of the rules, you see. Brass monkeys, another little illusion which you won't go into very much, I don't think. Not an air, I don't suppose, really, because it can be rather chilly on the beach, as we know. And brass can be used very well in the production of all kinds of aero engines. Sometimes when you pull them to pieces and inspect...
Right. So Derek Nimmo kept going to the whistle when gained that extra point. He's now equal in the lead with Peter Jones. Tony Hawks, your turn to begin. The subject is mollycoddling. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Miss Coddling took me for geography when I was at school, and it wasn't until many years later that I discovered that her first name was, in fact, Molly. Quite a woman she was. What she couldn't tell you about glacial erosion and oxbow lakes wasn't worth knowing. But where did she stand on mollycoddling? Well, she believed that you should not strike your children. But unfortunately, she had no objection to having a go at other people's. And I was on the receiving end of many blows from mollycoddling, let me tell you. And that has turned me into the upright, outstanding citizen I am.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Deviation is not.
I'm not going to ask the audience to judge on that, and I said I'm not going to judge it. But I tell you what we do, Derek. The audience applause assumes that they enjoyed the challenge, so you get a bonus point for the interruption. But Tony keeps the subject and a point for being interrupted, and he has 24 seconds to tell us more about mollycoddling, starting now.
If you are bringing up a child, please don't indulge in mollycoddling, because they will want to have their own way for the rest of their lives. When they go in restaurants, they will demand the food that they desire. They will pull their hair. They will tear away at your very souls until they have
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Fourth day.
There, yes, yes.
Yeah, so, you're right.
And we've got 7 seconds on mollycoddling, Derek, starting
if you
now.
Model collie a child too much, that will be not assumed to be mollycoddling. It's a totally different word.
Fred has challenged you. Fred, where's Fred? What is it?
Derek just said an anagram of mollycoddling.
Yes, sir.
Molly.
It was deviation from English as we understand it and as it's usually spoken. So, Fred, I agree with your challenge.
I wish you had
5 seconds on mollycoddling, starting now.
Mollycoddling would never entertain my...
Peter challenged.
What?
Yes, you challenged Peter.
Yes, I did, yes.
Why?
Well, he hesitated.
I know he did, I know, but I'd like to hear you say it. Right, mollycoddling's with you, Peter, and there is 1 second to go, starting now.
Well, he was talking about your mother.
Peter kept going. That 1 second to the whistle, and he's back in the lead with Derek Nimmo at the end of the round. And Fred MacAuley, it's your turn to begin. Back to basics. Talk on the subject if you can, Fred, starting now.
Back to basics was John Major's blueprint for life in the 90s. To combat sleaze, he decided that we should all behave in a manner that was appropriate, and we should have a family unit of small children, 2.4 maybe, a mother, a loving, caring father, and a live-in secretary, lover as well. And this was going to be the plan by which we would all be upstanding citizens and...
Peter, challenge again.
He hesitated again.
He did indeed, Peter. Correct challenge. Another point to you. 36 seconds available. Back to basics, starting now.
Well, when I first heard the phrase from John Major's own lips, I thought he was talking about getting back to the times when we lived in caves and when we had to go and kill something in order to have a meal. Or if we felt a bit like a bit of rumpo, we would have to go and find a woman and drag her by the hair... into the cave.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
There is no cave.
I'm afraid there's more than one cave.
Yes.
It's a pity, because I was enjoying this rumpo sequence.
Yes, well, Here you are.
Right, 13 seconds available. Back to basics with you, Derek, starting now.
Back to basics. Well, it did seem to be an admirable idea, returning to Victorian values in a way. But unfortunately, they've shot their own feet, have they not? And it doesn't really seem to have worked. I'm all for Peter Jones.
So, it's neck and neck with all of them. Derek, your turn to begin the subject, racing.
Tell us something about that in just a minute, if you can, starting now.
I'm frightfully keen on racing, particularly air. What's the matter now?
He actually started before you said now, and therefore is going to talk for just a minute and 1 second.
Actually,
that's not fair. He gets to talk for a minute and 1 second. We only get a minute.
Well, Tony, there's nothing in the rules that says you can't start before.
Right, I'm starting my next round now, then.
I'm going to give you a bonus point, Tony. Derek gets a point for being interrupted. He keeps the subject. 58 seconds, racing Derek, starting now.
The race course at Ayr is particularly celebrated. I noticed there the other day there was a meeting called, called the Warren and Norris Celebration Wedding Stakes Handicap. Now, why was it like that? I thought it was a very extraordinary thing. Well, I like going racing most of all, of course, is Australia. I have been to 16 Melbourne Cups, and I like the picnic race meetings.
Tony Hawk sounds.
Repetition of like.
Yes, you liked an awful lot before, yes, so...
Well, I like...
And you went to the Melbourne Cup 16 times.
Repetition, if ever I heard it, yes. 35 seconds for you on racing, Tony, starting now.
I know what horses are thinking about in racing. They are musing to themselves, how come when humans break their legs, they just put it in plaster? And you can see their point of view, can't you? But whenever I go racing, I make sure that I'm in a nice outfit and that everyone will be impressed by my stride as I run ahead of the throng of runners who are alongside me. Racing is...
Fred MacAuley challenged.
I don't know quite what the challenge is, but he was running ahead of them and now they're alongside him, so he's obviously not running very well.
Fred, 11 seconds for you on racing, starting now.
I've only ever once bet on a horse race, and I won. I put the money on a horse which was called Out in Front.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Two horses.
There were two horses. Horse race.
Oh, there were far more than two. What kind of horse race is that? What do you mean? You've been to the Melbourne Cup, Derek.
Derek, racing's back with you with 6 seconds to go, starting now.
Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum is one of the most successful owners at present, situated in Dubai, and founder with his brother of the Dolphin.
So Derek Nimmo got the subject back. He kept going to the whistle when gained extra points. He's now taken lead. Peter Jones, your turn to begin. Hotchpotch. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, it's just a fairly meaningless mixture. I mean, I could talk about anything, really. I could mention Tony Hawk's lurid sex life. I could talk about Nicholas...
Derek, challenge.
Two talks.
You were talking too much, I'm sorry, Peter.
Oh, dear.
Yes, yes. So, Derek, you have 51 seconds on this subject of hotchpotch, starting now.
Well, a hotchpotch can be an odd mixture of things, like, I suppose, the questions on this particular program, if one comes to think about it. Stress and brass and mollycoddling, back to basics, air, mooning, stretching my
Fred
legs.
Challenge.
Sorry, I know it's my first show, Derek, but I interrupted on behalf of Peter Jones.
I'd rather hear about Tony Hawk's lurid sex life.
I have to say, I'm rather keen as well.
I'm almost tempted to offer you two bonus points for a change. Give you a bonus point for that one, Fred. Leave it with Derek and Hotchpotch starting now.
It is a kind of stew by definition. You can put all kinds of vegetables and meat and rather like scouse, I suppose. I am a Liverpudlian.
Oh, and Tony's pressed. Yes.
I'm just pressing to stop you gesticulating at me to press. You thought he repeated kind, but he didn't. He said kind and kinds.
Did he?
Yes, you see.
Oh, right. So I was trying to help Fred then.
I just wanted to press to stop you going completely mad.
What happened to my hotchpotch?
You've still got it, and you have 30 seconds, Derek, starting...
30 seconds?
That's all. No, 29 now. Starting now. Tony challenged.
Well, hesitation. Yes.
Yes, Tony, you have a point. You have the subject. 29 seconds, Hotchpotch, starting now.
Whenever I'm in the kitchen and I need to cook something, I look around for all kinds of ingredients and throw them into the tub as if I am going to cook a real Hotchpotch of...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Did he say he threw them into the tub?
Yes, into the tub.
I mistook my kitchen for the bathroom, I'm afraid.
So... his cooking's like, can you imagine what his sex life's like?
You're going to have to imagine, because I'm not going to tell you.
Peter, correct challenge. 20 seconds. Hotchpotch, starting now.
Well, rather than tell you about him, I'd rather talk about the Parsons family, whom I have known about for many years now. His grandfather designed the Tay Bridge, and then much later, his son designed the Titanic.
Tony, you challenge.
Were there two designs?
There were two. He designed the second time. The
was first it designs? Time was, why was it designs the first
designs
time?
Designs the first time, and the well, designed he, the second time.
Why did he do it in the present tense in the first time?
I don't know. Why did he do it in the first tense?
Well, I don't know. Perhaps I had a temporary blackout.
Yes. Well, your temporary
I have been having a very difficult time lately. And, you know, there's difficulties at home and one way and another. And I do plead...
Oh, your cri de coeur from the heart has won you the subject back. 5 seconds.
Where else could a cri de coeur come from apart from a heart?
That is a very good question, Barry. 5 seconds for Hotchpotch with you, Peter, starting now.
It can be a very nice dish if you get the right ingredients and a pan to put it all in.
So, Peter Jones, speaking then as the whistle went, has moved forward into second place behind our leader, Derek Nimmo. Tony Hawkes, your turn to begin the subject, Riding a Laugh. We've discussed that often in just a minute. Talk on the subject, if you can, starting now.
Why did the one-armed monkey fall out of the tree? Because I waved to him. Now, because I'm still talking now, that's an example of riding a laugh. Were I to stop and let you fully enjoy the magnificence of that gag, I would be buzzed by one of my fellow panellists who would accuse me of hesitating. But that would not be the case. However, some comedians struggle to find the opportunity to ride a laugh because they don't get any. That is their particular tragedy, and I will not go into that now. Instead, I will tell you about a horse that my brother used to...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
He said, I will, twice, very
I will,
close together.
I will. Peter, well listened, and 26 seconds available. We're riding a laugh, starting now.
Well, it's something that people do, I suppose, if they ever get laughs. And I've never been terrible.
Peter Eric Nimmo, challenge.
And his
and there was no, yes.
Oh, so there was. Yeah, I'm rather glad, really. I didn't want to go on.
I have to say, Peter, that's exactly how you came across to me as well. 21 seconds,
riding a laugh. Derek, starting now.
Our laugh is the impeccably bred new coat by Shamdan Ashim, which is one of Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum's favourite horses.
Also, a challenge.
I think he should speak mostly English.
Actually, I have to give the benefit of the doubt to Derek Nimmo and say there are 10 seconds for riding a laugh, Derek, starting now.
I must say, I wish I could tell jokes like Terry. He's so witty and funny, isn't he? I'd love to be able to ride a laugh as he does with the aplomb.
Tony, stop that.
Well, I'm afraid there were two loves in there, I'm quite prepared to give you coaching lessons, if you like.
4 seconds with you, Tony. Riding a laugh, starting now.
It was a filly owned by an Arabic gentleman, and I...
Tony Hawkes was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so. Peter, it's neck and neck between you and Derek Nimmo. He's one point ahead of you as we go into the last round, and you are 3 points ahead of Tony Hawkes, and Fred is trailing just a little. And but don't worry, Fred. It's the contribution that counts.
Thank you.
The points are secondary. And, Fred, it is your turn to begin. I don't think you can actually win, but we'll certainly enjoy hearing from you on my ambition starting now.
Yeah, well, my ambition had been to win, but obviously that's not going to happen. So it's important that I let you know the difference between fantasy and ambition. Because if you were to ask any young man, say, 13 or 14 years old, what his ambition was, he might say, a night out with Pamela Anderson. And that is an idea of how the difference is between the word that I said earlier that isn't ambition, that began with an F and rhymes with fantasy.
Peter, you challenge.
There's no such word as fantasy.
No, I think it was the Perthshire accent when he said fantasy, you know. He's come from Perthshire, that fellow does.
But this is going all over the world. It's not a parochial programme at all.
Fred, yes. I disagree with the challenge because I think you said fantasy as well.
Thank you very much.
And you keep going on the subject of my ambition. 34 seconds are left, starting now.
It would be a shame to just have one ambition. I think you should have more than one ambition. You should have several.
Tony Hawk's challenge.
Quite a lot of shoulds in there.
Yeah, a lot of shoulds,
quite a lot
yes.
of ones as well.
Yeah. And, Tony, my ambition is the subject, and there are 29 seconds available, starting now.
I'd like to star in a TV consumer programme that showed absolutely no sympathy at all for the people that wrote in, and it was called Tough Tit, You Bought It. My ambition also, on top of that, is to publish a book. Notice the way I'm riding that laugh as well. Publish a book entitled...
Yeah. A Fred challenge.
Yeah, two publishers there.
Yeah, we published, yes, you published too much there. So, yeah. Fred, you've got the subject backed. You're going to finish in style with 9 seconds on My Ambition, starting now.
My ambition would be, like Tony, to publish two books. One of the books would be...
Oh. Oh, it's a tough game, isn't it, Fred? Yes. 5 seconds are left, and Derek Nimmo got in first. My ambition, Derek, starting now.
My ambition will be to the chairman of this wonderful programme when Nicholas Parson finally retires.
We have no more time to play Just a Minute, alas, so it remains for me to give you the final score. Fred MacAuley, who has not played the game before, coming from nowhere, did magnificently.
He comes from Glasgow.
He comes from Perthshire, but in this game he came from nowhere, finished in fourth place with a lot of points. He did marvellously. Tony Hawks, who's come from somewhere as well.
I came from nowhere. We all came from nowhere at the beginning.
Right. But in this show, he finished in third place, quite a lot of points. Peter Jones nearly pipped our leader, 2 points behind the man who held the lead and lost it and held it again to finish up as our winner this week, Derek Nimmo. It only remains for me to say, on behalf of our four intrepid players of the game, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Fred MacAuley and Tony Hawks, thanking them very much. Also Liz Trott for keeping the score and for blowing the whistle marvellously, I thought. And also we must thank Ian Messiter for thinking of the game, which we all enjoy playing so much, and our producer Anne Jobson for directing it so magnificently. This is me, Nicholas Parsons, on behalf of all of us saying goodbye. Hope you'll join us the next time we play Just a Minute. Welcome to Just a Minute. Yes. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to introduce the four talented performers who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back two of the regular older players of the game, which is Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo. We welcome another regular player from a different generation, that's Paul Merton, and someone who's never played the game before, that is Maria McCurlane. Would you please welcome all four of them? The
Beside me sits Yolanta Zabuki, and on this show she will keep a score, blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I will ask the players of the game to speak on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the city of Nottingham. And we will start the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, well, who else to begin a show from Nottingham than Robin Hood? Will you talk about Robin Hood for 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Well, I'm sorry to repeat you, but Robin Hood and his merry men. Allan a Dale, Will Scarlet, Friar Tuck, Little John. What a gathering they were. These chaps who wandered through Sherwood Forest. But, you know, the city of Nottingham, they seem to concentrate too much, I think, on Robin Hood. You've got other great citizens of this fine county. Why do you only emphasize Robin Hood? What about Byron, the great lord who was born here? Why not have instead about...
Paul Merton has challenged.
Repetition of why not?
Why not? Yes. The audience laughed.
Mean challenges you do, actually.
No, I don't think I was having a very good challenge, and you had been going for 34 seconds as well. And it's nice to hear from somebody else. Paul Merton got in first. And, of course, it's a correct challenge. He gains a point for that. He takes over the subject, and there are 26 seconds left, starting now.
Robin Hood stole from the rich and gave to the poor, which is the exact opposite of the National Lottery. I remember seeing the television series Robin Hood starring Richard Green. What a wonderful programme that was, made in those far-off days in the 1950s where black-and-white programmes were the norm on television.
And Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of programme.
Yes, those wonderful programmes, black and white programmes.
Programme and programmes, wasn't it?
I think you're right, actually, yes. Mm. So, Clement, I'm sorry, an incorrect challenge. So Paul gets a point for an incorrect challenge, keeps the subject, and there are 14 seconds left, starting now.
Errol Flynn made his name in Hollywood.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of made.
Yes, you said... Clement, you've cleverly got in with 12 seconds on Robin Hood. And a point, of course, for a correct challenge, starting now.
Robin Hood was a 14th century legend, according to pornographers who ascribe Piers Plowman, printed in 1377, as mentioning him before...
It is Clement Freud who's taken the lead at the end of the round. Paul Merton, will you take the next round? The subject is rabbit. We've had quite a lot of rabbiting in this programme over the years, but will you talk on the subject? 60 seconds, starting now.
When I was younger, we had a lovely pet rabbit called Gordon. He was fluffy, white, everything a rabbit should be, and one Sunday we had him for lunch. I don't mean that we ate him, we actually invited him to join us at our dinner table on the Sabbath, and he came along and he dressed up neatly in a nice little tuxedo and was very pleased because we thought, well, what do you give a rabbit? So we thought, well, he's eat his own dung. So we put that on a plate with some Brussels sprouts, and I must say this rabbit was more than pleased with himself. And after a while, he actually developed, I don't know how, a singing voice, and he used to entertain all the old people down at the local retirement home with his versions of the Johnny Mathis hits like Winter Wonderland and When a Child is Born.
And Maria McCurley has challenged. Maria.
I don't believe him.
It's lovely to hear from you, Maria. It's one of those impossible decisions in Just a Minute because...
Well,
I mean,
you do believe me, do you?
No, it says that if you wish to keep going, you can go into a flight of fantasy, which is great fun and so forth. But as you haven't played the game before, Maria, and we'd love to hear from you, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt and say that you have a point, of course, 18 seconds on rabbit, starting now.
Rabbits, for me, have always been associated with myxomatosis, a word that I learnt as a child, and I always thought was a Greek archbishop, much like Macarius for much of my youth. And so when I heard the song Bright Eyes by Art Garfunkel, I realised that myxomatosis made the rabbit...
I'm sorry, Derek challenged with a quarter
of myxomatosis.
Okay. I know, she didn't actually get the word out before you pressed your buzzer.
He hates me.
That'd be a correct challenge if she hadn't got the word out.
I don't know.
I was going to say myxomataxis, actually.
Just psychic challenges.
I'm going to say, because she challenged in the middle of the word and you hadn't actually got it out, you didn't actually repeat myxomatosis. I'm giving a logical interpretation here and say that it was an incorrect challenge, so you have another point and you have quarter of a second on rabbit starting now. poorly challenged.
A repetition of myxomatose.
You can't have retrospective challenges, and she hasn't said anything on that particular occasion, so that's another incorrect challenge. And you have 1/7 of a second on rabbit, starting now. Derek, challenge.
Hesitation. Continue.
The whistle should have gone in 1/7 of a second. Right. Maria got a point for not speaking when the whistle went.
Thank you.
And at the end of that round, she's got about 3 points, and she's in the lead at the end of the round. Clement Freud, will you take the next round? The subject is barge. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
A barge is a slow-moving, flat-bottomed thing, rather like Nicholas Parsons, only goes on water. And if you go to the canal here in Nottingham, you will see barges, usually two of them, motors and butties, the latter one of these having a kitchen and a dining room, whereas the former has the engine which propels the pair of boats up and down towards wherever north and south lead to. Barges also were used for shoulder pushing another footballer or rugby player in order to keep possession of a ball which the other person, he who makes physical contact, may well be trying to establish. The Royal Barge, on which Her Majesty the Queen inspects the troops, or the Navy, or indeed the Air Force or other, goes up and down the River Thames.
Paul Merton has challenged.
Repetition of up and down.
Yes, you did go up and down before, I'm afraid, Clement, yes. Oh. And, Paul, you've got in with 3 seconds to go on the subject of barge, starting now.
My pet rabbit Gordon used to work on a barge.
So Paul Merton was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so, and he's taken the lead at the end of that round. Maria McAuley, your turn to begin. The subject, habits. We've had rabbits, now we have habits. Can you talk on that subject in just a minute, starting now?
Habits are something that I know quite a lot about. Being a convent girl myself, and it's true that convent girls do indeed have very bad...
Derek,
repetition of convent.
Yes, and so, Derek, a point to you, and there are 53 seconds starting now.
I know it's very difficult to get out of old habits. I was brought up and taught by my mother always to open doors to let ladies go through, to stand up on a crowded tram or car or railway train to let members of the fair sex and the old people like me sit down. But this doesn't really happen anymore. I was in a lift only yesterday, and I stood back, and a woman wouldn't go past me because I was waiting her to park. You see, these very old habits, it's very difficult to get rid of them. I think this world is becoming a very discourteous place, not so charming. I think manners do maketh man, and manners are something which I've said before, so I rather regret it, actually.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of myxomatosis.
No, there was a repetition of manners. Well done. 14 seconds are left for habits with you, Paul, starting now.
I have a habit of chewing other people's fingernails, and this really annoys them. They may be out shopping or perhaps at a football match, and suddenly I will creep up behind them, grab hold of their hand and bite right into the end of that digit that's...
So Paul Merton was then speaking once again as the whistle went, gained an extra point, and has increased his lead at the end of that round. And it's his turn to begin, and the subject is stars. starting now.
Mary Pickford was generally acknowledged as the very first star of the cinema. She became known as Little... Well, I can't say it because it's her first name repeated. But audiences in America loved her. She used to play sort of gammon roles. This is a very odd word now. You don't hear it. It's not like gammon, which sounds... which is a kind of bacon. It's another word, which obviously I can't mention again. She started working in the 1908, I believe it was, for a director called D.W. Griffith, and she made a series of films for a studio called Pathé. Now, these particular movies were so popular with audiences of the time that they had to know who she was, because generally the policy at that...
Clement Freud, challenge first.
Hesitation.
Hesitation. Yeah. 16 seconds, Clement. Stars, tell us something about them, starting now.
I'm very keen on the plough, a constellation which you catch if you look for the northern star, and an eye line will reach the constellation which I've just mentioned before.
So, Maria, you challenged.
Yes, I challenged because he hesitated and went
no,
to the
No, he went, he repeated constellation.
All right. But also, I was going to say...
Why don't you come and play the game instead of just sitting there?
I don't think you can catch a star either, which I think Clement mentioned.
Oh, yes, catch it from your pocket.
No, but that's rubbish, as we know. You can't
catch
a star.
No, I've done it regularly.
Have you?
When it's one of my pastimes, yes.
But you're on drugs, Nicholas.
No. Maria, you have 1 second to tell us something about stars starting now. Derek, you challenge.
Hesitation.
Oh, yes, please.
Well,
am I allowed an intake of breath? Have I just got to be ready with my breath
now? I always say, yes, I'm afraid you have. They're wicked. They give no quarter. So, Derek, you have 1/2 second on stars starting now.
The Milky Way.
No, Maria challenged you.
No, I said that. Before you said now, I said the Milky Way.
I know, but you also challenged. What was your challenge?
Just being irritating, really.
So Derek Nimmo was speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point for doing so, and Clement Freud, it's your turn to begin. The subject, punch. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Punch is the Hindu word for 5, that being the number of ingredients in the drink punch. I think aromatics, alcohol, spice, fruit, and of course the most important, water. Go into any bar and ask for punch, and the majority of what you will have in your glass, the major part of it, will be...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Part.
Part, yes, you did say part.
Parts and part.
No, it was parts before. I'm sorry, you're quite right, Clement. Subject is still with you, Clement. Punch, 35 seconds, starting now.
Punch is also if you hit somebody in the face, especially with a boxing glove in a ring, when Frank Warren or one of those promoters pays you huge sums of money, and television networks, which are not terrestrial, but only able to be watched by those who are moneyed or like to pay huge sums towards watching...
Maria,
repetition of sums.
Yes, and 11 seconds are available for you, Maria, on Punch, starting now.
Punch was an early wife-beater who lived with somebody called Judy, and I believe he also lived with a crocodile.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He lived with too many people.
Yes. Yes. So lived, repetition, 2 seconds, Derek. Punch starting
Gosh,
now.
Gosh, I don't like boxing very much. I used to belong to the World Sporting Club, and go and see all those people slogging each other.
So, Derek Nimmo. Speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point, he's equal now in second place with Maria McCurlain, and Paul Merton is still in the lead. And Maria, it is your turn to begin. The subject, sponge. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Sponge is a good word to describe the top of my thighs. Probably because I eat too much of the jam and cream variety and not enough of the trainer variety of sponge. Oh, variety.
Yes, Clement Freud challenge.
I don't believe it.
Forty-five seconds, sponge starting now.
Sponge is a lowly sort of animal life. It has an IQ of hardly anything at all. And you can use it in a bath, which shows what a negative substance it is, to scrub your thighs or anyone else's, regardless of what shape they might be. I had a sponge in a hotel bedroom, which I used to frequent in Sutherland.
Maria, you challenge.
Deviation that he had a sponge in a hotel bedroom, surely.
What's you, known
get
as
your,
al-
you get your pleasure where you can.
And we will give you a bonus point, Maria, because we enjoyed the challenge, but he wasn't actually deviating in any sense. So, Clement, you have a point for being interrupted. You keep the subject. 19 seconds, sponge, starting now.
There used to be a Turkish bath in Russell Square, I think the Imperial, and...
Paul challenge.
Hesitation?
Yes, I think so, Paul. Sponge is with you, and there are 13 seconds left starting now.
Mr. Kipling is known for his sponges. Apparently, they are exceedingly good. He gets the ingredients, which Clement will probably know, but I shall tell those of you out there who aren't entirely sure of what you need to make a sponge.
So Paul Merton once again was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and has increased his lead at the end of that round. Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, Sally Forth. Will you talk on it? 60 seconds, starting now.
A very great friend of mine called Geoffrey Palmer reached middle age without having got married. He does a series called Second Time Around, which you may see on television quite frequently, and he drew up a list of people that he thought would be eligible to be his bride. First, of course, came Judi Dench. Secondly, Edwina Curry. And thirdly, Shirley Bassey. They all turned him down, but Sally Forth won. And she is... Actually, her maiden name was Sally Green. And she...
Clement, you challenge?
Repetition of Green.
No. I think you thought it was the repetition of Sally, which is on the card. You can repeat what is on the card.
You think I thought...
Well, that's the only assumption I can make. And knowing your agile mind, you quickly change and hope to fox me by saying repetition of green. And I had to do a quick sort of recall and think, did he repeat green? And I didn't hear him say green before, so it was an incorrect challenge, but it was well tried. And Sally Forth is still with Derek Nimmo with 30 seconds left, starting now.
Bragadino, that famous Venetian general, used to sally forth from the walls of Famagusta when it was surrounded by the Turks through the Sally Gate and attacked them with such courage that he managed to hold the castle for some 1 year.
Paul Merton challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I agree, Paul. Tried to change the word, failed in the second, went 15 seconds left. And for you on Sally Forth, starting now.
Anybody in the audience who read girls' comics when they were younger will remember the Four Marys, but there was another equally nice strip called the Four Sallys.
Four. Clement. You've got him on the four. 6 seconds, Clement. Sally Forth, starting now.
I read recently that 96% of all journalists approve of condom machines in public conveniences. So...
I think the programme was saved by the whistle on that occasion. But Clement was speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so, and he's in second place, equal with Maria McCurlane, and Derek Nimmo's just behind, and Paul Merton's still in the lead. And it's Paul, your turn to begin. Swedes. Tell us something about them in this game, please, starting now.
I've never liked Swedes. They taste horrible, almost as bad as the vegetables. But if you want to cook a Swede, you must persuade him to climb into a very large pot. It's best if he takes his clothes off first, because otherwise you get this rather nasty, woolly aftertaste. And you put him in the oven for 2 or 3 hours, or until he stops screaming. And if you prepare a large vat of custard, that gives you something to do while he's actually boiling away. I've never been to Sweden, but my best friend has, and he said it's a wonderful country. You can walk around, and there are Swedes everywhere. You go into shops, there they are. Walk into any cinema you care.
Derek Nimmo, you're trying
to walk.
Yes, you were walking a bit too much there, and 20 seconds available for Swedes with you, Derek, starting now.
My favourite Swede is Rolf Schenlund, which is spelled T-S-E-R-L-U-N-D. Curious name. I met him, funnily enough, in Aberystwyth, which is not the sort of place you expect to meet a Swede. But there he was.
Clement Freud, challenge.
He didn't spell Aberystwyth.
Very few people can. But, Clement, an amusing challenge. We give you a bonus point for that because we enjoyed it, but he wasn't actually committing any of the sins of just a minute, so he gets another point for being interrupted. Keeps the subject, Derek. 6 seconds. Swedes starting
now. One of my favourite root vegetables...
Paul Merton.
Did we have favourite before?
Yes, because it was a favourite Swede before, and this was a favourite root vegetable. So, well done, Paul. 5 seconds on Swedes starting now.
I remember when we were served up our school dinners at the age of 7, I'd look it down...
Paul Merton was again speaking as a whistle when creased his lead at the end of the round. Clement Freud, your turn to begin, and the subject is Hector. Will you tell us something about him in this game, starting now?
Traditionally, in legend, Hector was Priam's eldest son, but it's also about 2.15 of an acre. And those of you who own property, as Mrs. Thatcher would be so pleased to learn, will realize that if you buy a 50-hectare plot, it is very much bigger than... Oh, this is very difficult.
Well, he couldn't follow through with that, could he?
I agree with your challenge. And carry on for 35 seconds, if you can, on Hector, starting now.
Hector had a house in my childhood, along with Kiki. I think this followed...
Derek, challenge.
Repetition of key.
Oh, dear. I think his name was Kiki and not Key hyphen Key.
It was a she.
It was a she. I know it was, yes. Maria, I'm not going to lie.
I think I've lost the will to live anyway.
I think you've got 29 seconds on Hector starting now.
Hector and hectoring is something that stand-up comedians often suffer.
Clement, challenge. I think so, yes. Yeah. Hector's back with you, Clement. 23 seconds starting now.
Hector's really an excellent name for a dog. Spelt H-E-C-T-O-R.
Or... Paul challenged.
That's not how you spell dog.
So if one's going to be logical, I've got to give it to Paul. Okay, Paul, 15 seconds. Hector starting now.
The programme to which Maria was referring to earlier was Hector's House.
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
Grammatically.
Yes,
the program to which Maria was referring to.
We can be colloquial. Well, I'm not going to lie. No, Paul,
no,
carry
Brian
on.
Brian Shepherd's very much opposed to the sort of decision you're given.
She's never played just a minute. And never likely to. 11 seconds, Paul. 11 seconds, Paul, on Hector, starting now.
Kevin Hector was a very popular player with Derby County in the mid-1970s, and although we are speaking from the wonderful situation of Nottingham, there may indeed be some fans of that particular...
Paul Merton gained another extra point, speaking as the whistle went, and he's in a very strong lead. As we go into the last round, if you want to know, Clement Freud's in second place, then Maria McCurlane, and then Derek Nimmo, equal with Maria. And Maria, it's your turn to begin. So will you take the last round and talk on fripperies, if you can, for just a minute, starting now.
Fripperies are items of meaningless consequence or useless trifles, although in my experience, trifles can never be...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Too much trifle.
Mm-hmm. Too much trifle,
that's
yes.
I've got spongy thighs.
No, no. Derek, 52 seconds are left for fripperies. Will you tell us something
actually,
about...
Actually, my family made their money, curious enough, near here in Ilkeston, by making fripperies lace. They had factories round there and indeed in Nottingham. And I spent a lot of my youth looking at these now vanished fabrics because they couldn't sell them anymore. That was what was a tremendous sadness. These great mills went broke and the whole of Nottingham collapsed.
Repetition of Nottingham.
Nottingham, yes. You mentioned Nottingham before.
Oh, why not?
I know, why not? Thirty-one seconds for you, Paul, on fripperies, starting now.
Nottingham, 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 Nottingham.
So, Derek Nimmo challenge. Derek, you've got in again on fripperies, 29 seconds, starting now.
I used to go down Petticoat Lane on a Sunday morning looking for little fripperies that I could give to my wife.
Clement Freud challenge.
When I returned.
Repetition of little.
You mentioned little before.
When?
Right at the beginning, when you were talking about
late. Tell me the sentence, please.
He was listening.
I can't give you the exact quote, but you were talking about the little places you were to go to and these lovely little lace things that were made.
I never said there were little. That would be a grave slur on Nottingham. It was the centre of the lace trade.
Well, I've got a feeling this programme's being taped, so we could listen back.
Of course I said little. I'm not disputing about that. But if you've got repetition, you've got to say little twice. Just think about it, Nicholas. Go on, stay. Get your abacus out and work it out.
If he gets his abacus out, I'm going home.
All right, Derek didn't repeat the word little. Derek, you have 11 seconds on the final round to tell us something more about fripperies, starting now.
Go to Harrods any day of the week and you will...
Paul Merton challenge.
Not if you go on a Sunday.
They open on a Sunday.
Logic. Open on a Sunday?
Yeah.
But even if they weren't open, you could still go to Harrods on a Sunday. So it's right. Not illogical.
And all right, can I change it then?
No. It's too late.
Can I have non-repetition of the word little?
Derek, you have another point. You have 10 seconds on fripperies starting now.
Nottingham Goose Fair is probably the best place in the whole wide world. Not only have tremendous fun, but also the
Maria
much
challenge.
Repetition of tremendous from earlier on.
You did say tremendous earlier on.
Did I?
Yes, definitely. Maria's got in with 3 seconds to go on fripperies, starting now.
Fripperies also...
And Derek Nimmo challenges. No. Right. Maria's got another point. 2 seconds. Fripperies starting now.
Fripperies are long, thin tubes of donut.
Yay! Right. So that last exhausting round has finally come to an end. I do hope you've enjoyed Just a Minute as much as we've enjoyed playing it. Let me give you the final score. Clement Freud actually finished in fourth place, which is unusual. Only 1 point behind Maria, and she was only 1 point behind Derek Nimmo, and they were all a few points behind Paul Merton. So we say the most points, here's our winner this week. It remains me to say thank you to our four delightful players of the game, Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Maria McCurlane and Derek Nimmo. I also must thank Yolanta Zabuki, who has kept the score for the first time and blown her whistle with great aplomb. Also our producer, Anne Jobson, who looks after us and keeps an eye on our shenanigans. And also the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, who thought it up and kept us in work for over 28 years. And from me, Nicholas Parsons. Hope you've enjoyed the show. Tune in again next time we take the air and play Just a Minute. Goodbye! Welcome to Just a Minute.
my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome our audience to the show and introduce the four talented performers who are going to play the game this week. We welcome back two long-standing players of the game, that is Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones, and on the other side we welcome two more recent players of the game, somebody who's played it with great success a few times, that is Tony Hawks, and someone who's never actually played it on the radio before, that is Graham Norton. Will you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Yolanta Zubuki, who is going to blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up and also keep the score. And as usual, I'm going to ask our four panellists to speak without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the delightful Playhouse Theatre in the beautiful little town of Alnwick in Northumberland. We actually have come up on the train today, and thanks to British Rail, three of us got here. And... And the fourth one, Tony Hawks, missed the stop on the train. But thanks to the courtesy of British Rail, they opened a back door at a station which has never been opened before and let him off just in time for the recording. Let us begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Derek, the subject, castles. Will you tell us something about castles in just a minute, starting now?
Well, it could hardly be more appropriate in this part of the world, because there are so many beautiful castles near to where we are at present in Alnwick. Harbottle Castle, Raby Castle, and of course the huge Percy Castle, which dominates the town. I haven't been here for 40 years, and unfortunately when I arrived tonight, it was rather dark, so I couldn't see it again. But I launched it at lion, the great stiff tail that sticks out. There was a column erected here, you know, Nicholas, by the grateful tenants. A thousand of them pay because the Duke had reduced their tenants.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Sort of hesitation.
Yes, absolutely. It was definitely hesitation. So Peter gets a point for a correct challenge. He takes over the subject, and there are 31 seconds left to tell us something about castles, starting now.
My wife, who is an American, believed that the phrase "an Englishman's home is his castle." She thought it meant that people, men of this island race, were so proud of their castles.
Derek Nimmo challenge. Yes, I think there was hesitation.
Well, it was very like his.
Repetition.
Derek, will you take back the subject of castles with 16 seconds to go, starting now?
I greatly enjoy making sand castles, Chateau de Sable, on the beach, anywhere you can find them, as I now have grandchildren. It is a huge excitement for me to have a little bucket and a spade, and I bang them out, and I stick flags on the top, and I wait till the tide comes.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. And it was Derek Nimmo, and at the end of that round, he not only has most points, but he's naturally in the lead. And Tony Hawks, will you take the second subject and talk about squash in 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Things you don't want to hear if you're hoping to have a good time. One, we're having a party, bring some squash. Two, I'm really at a loose end this evening, Tony. Let's get together, go up the club and play some squash. Or three, feel free to go to the toilet in here, but don't mind all of us, it might be a bit of a squash. Now, these are examples of how squash is a pejorative term. But of course, I love the game. Squash was a brilliant player, beat...
Derek Nimmo challenge. You talked about the game of squash before, and there are 32 seconds left for you, Derek, having got another point, to take over squash, starting now.
What I really like to do is to squash some fresh limes, mix it with a proportion of tequila.
Peter Jones challenge.
Hesitation.
I think so too, Peter. Yes. Another point to you, Peter. 25 seconds on squash, starting now.
I'm reminded of those bottles of squash which ornament the centre court at Wimbledon during the tennis fortnight. And I'm amazed that nobody ever seems to drink it. They always go for the Coca-Cola. And I feel this is not only...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
This is unfair. He's sponsored by Coca-Cola.
Yeah. Tony, it wasn't committing any of the sins of just a minute, but as we enjoyed the challenge and the audience endorsed that, we give you a bonus point for that. But Peter gets a point for being interrupted, and he keeps the subject, and there are 8 seconds left, Peter, on squash starting now.
Now, there was some rival on sale in America when I was last there, which on the label it said, all the happy...
No. Just before the whistle went, Graham Norton challenge.
No.
How nice to hear from you.
No.
You may not have played the game before, Graham, but you've got onto one of the clever arts of it. Graham, what is your challenge?
What was it again? Oh, it was hesitation, wasn't it?
I think it was hesitation.
Yes, it was hesitation.
Yes, definitely okay. Hesitation. You have half a second, Graham, on squash starting now.
Squash is barbecue. What?
So at the end of the second round, Derek, Nimmo and Peter Jones are equal in the lead. Peter, the subject is cheerfulness, something which you create if you don't always exude it, and you talk on the subject starting now.
Well, it's a wonderful quality, and I always admire it in other people. Some of them have it all their lives, and you never meet them when they aren't exuding cheerfulness.
Derek, Nimmo, challenge.
Hesitation.
I think so, Derek. You have cheerfulness with you. 51 seconds starting now.
Well, Adrenix, you are a perpetually cheerful person, and if I was going to wander through the slough of despond or trudge through the valley of the shadow of death or even to visit Cold Comfort Farm, you're the very person, old Nick himself, that I would take with me.
Peter Jones, why...
I didn't know who he was talking about. Old Nick, is it?
Old Nick, he's not the devil, he was talking about me.
Oh, he was?
Yes, that's right.
Well, that's obviously why I could never guess.
Peter, I show you how sporting I am. In spite of that, I will give you a bonus point because the audience enjoyed the challenge. But Derek keeps the subject and a point for being interrupted, and there are 37 seconds for him to continue telling them about cheerfulness, starting now.
In spite of his advanced age, he remains terribly cheerful, and we admire him for it. On the train today, he was sitting there beaming, signing autographs, being pleasant to everyone. When a passing guard came by, he gave a cheery wave and a blessing, because he's that sort of fellow. He's a downright jolly good egg, and you don't see many of those around today. I'm very pleased to have been associated with him for all these 28 years, and I would like you now to show your appreciation.
Tony Hawks.
I can't stand any more of this crawling.
So what is your challenge?
Deviation. He wasn't talking about cheerfulness. He was. I don't know what he was trying to do to you. I think he's trying to get in your hotel room tonight.
Well, considering he normally takes the mickey out of me, I fully appreciate it, and it's lovely to hear it coming from Derek, of all people. And also, he absolutely, for my mind, made it quite clear that he was talking about cheerfulness, and for some reason he thinks I epitomise it. So I disagree with the challenge,
well,
I'm afraid.
There's a turn up for the books.
I think he was just trying to be charitable and help you to make a comeback.
I've been here for 29 years in the show, Peter. Sorry.
It's only been game for 28.
No, Derek, I know you're getting a little bit older as well, but actually this is the 29th series we're doing.
Is it really?
It is indeed, yes.
Derek, has that turned you against Derek then now?
No. No, he still has the subject. 10 seconds. Cheerfulness, Derek, starting now.
I think if one wanders through the streets of London, which one seldom...
Tony Hawk's a challenge.
I think you wandered through earlier on in the first...
You were wandering a bit before, yes.
I was not wandering at all.
You wandered
I have not said the word wander all night.
You said it three times now,
anyway. Tony, I was a bit harsh before, so I think I'll be generous and say, yes, you have a correct challenge. You have 6 seconds on cheerfulness, starting now.
Cheerfulness often results in laughter, which comes from jokes, like what's red and sits in the corner, a naughty strawberry. All right.
Tony Hawks was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so, and at the end of that round, Derek Nimmo's just in the lead ahead of Peter Jones, followed by Tony Hawks and Graham Norton in that order. Graham, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is dreams. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
Freud is often associated with dreams. He placed a great importance on them, though I feel myself that he just pretended they were important. Because psychotherapy is so boring, most of his clients would just nod off on his leather couchette. And he felt a bit guilty charging them for nothing more than a kip. So when they woke up, he'd pretend that what they were saying had some sort of import or meaning. A lot of adolescent boys, healthy, young, bursting souls that they are, though this never happened to me myself, have what are known in psychotherapy parlance as vet dreams.
As that was Graham Norton's first attempt at speaking, hesitation, repetition, deviation, just a minute, the others let him go, and he really went magnificently. In fact, I think he went too far on occasions. But by the way, if anybody does go for a full minute without being interrupted, they not only get the point for speaking when the whistle went, but they also gain a bonus point for not being interrupted. So, Graham, you have 2 points for that round.
Oh, hip, hip,
hip. So you don't get a car or anything like that? Because really, frankly, a car would be more useful than an extra car.
Especially for you and your experience with trains. All right, so at the end of that round, Derek is still in the lead, but followed by Graham Norton and Peter Jones, who are equal. And Tony Hawks, your turn to begin. The subject, brainwaves. Will you tell us something about those in this game, starting now?
One of the best brainwaves I ever had was went into the store next and take one of their badges off the assistant and then put it on the next time I was in a post office queue. Another brilliant brainwave I had was to go into one of those restaurants where they say, eat as much as you can for a tenner.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
You said go into first the post office.
You repeated the phrase. Peter, a point, the subject, and 42 seconds to tell us something about brainwaves, starting now.
Well, they used to be called ideas, and there haven't been many good ones lately in the last 20 or so years. The poll tax was a bad one. Nouveau cuisine was another.
Derek, Nimmo, challenge you.
Hesitation.
There was an definitely, before nouveau cuisine, Peter.
Yes, there was.
Yeah. No, Derek, you have the subject. You have 32 seconds. Oh, I love the sporting way you handle it, Peter. Right, 32 seconds. Brainwaves with you, Derek, starting now.
I think it's an absolute brainwave of the chairman of this theatre to write to the National Lottery, ask them some money so they could put in a lift. And apparently that aforesaid body has awarded them no less than £275,000 to refurbish this splendid place. I congratulate you all. I think it's wonderful good news. And complete and total brainwave. I had a brainwave myself.
Graham Norton's challenge.
Well, now, isn't it brainwaves?
That is right.
And so that was a repetition of brainwave.
Not one brainwave.
I know, but the subject on the card, which you can repeat, on this occasion is brainwaves, and you said about the chairman of the theatre having a brainwave, and you now repeated the word brainwave. So, Graham, well listened. You have a correct challenge. There are only 5 seconds for you on brainwaves, starting now, Graham.
I once lived next door to some intelligent people, and their brainwaves caused havoc with my television reception.
Peter Jones, your turn to begin. The subject is rackets. Can you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, there are quite a lot of rackets. Some of them are to do with the National Lottery, I'm afraid to say, but not in the case of this particular theatre. It would have been nice to have had a lift in time for my arrival, or certainly my departure, when I hope, call in at the hospitality room on my way. Now, a lot of rackets...
Derek Nimmo, chance.
Hesitation.
No, I don't think so,
no,
Derek.
I don't think so, either.
The rackets are still with you, Peter, having got another point for an incorrect challenge, and you continue with 40 seconds to go, starting now.
This town has one of the highest crime rates in the world. Including Chicago.
where they have an awful lot of rackets.
Tony Hawk's the challenge.
Well, of course you're including Chicago. It's in the world.
Yes.
You said it, one of the biggest crime rates in the world, including Chicago. I mean, you've already said in the world. We know Chicago's in the world.
Yes, I know, but we don't know that it's in the list of crime rates, you know, which have done a,
has to be,
a lot of research. I haven't come here unprepared, you know.
my argument is that...
And after I'd observed you through the train window, you know, absolutely blotter, and tried to get you to get yourself together to come here and try and malign me in this way, I think is very unfortunate.
Yes, I think you are being a little bit pedantic, actually, Tony, I must say so.
Where are we?
Where are we? We're talking about rackets.
And whether Chicago is in the world or not.
And I don't think Tony's quite recovered from the experience of going through Olmouth and not getting off the train in time. Yeah. Rackets is still with you, Peter. Another point, 27 seconds starting now.
Well, I've seen a lot of rackets at Wimbledon.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of well.
Oh.
He started with well. He came. I always write his wells. He always starts with well, so I write it down.
I know he starts. That's what I call a mean challenge. But it is a correct challenge, so I have to be fair within the rules of just a minute. Say 26 seconds for you, Derek, on rackets starting now.
One of the more unpleasant rackets, I think, is on a restaurant bill where they include service, often at 17.5%, and you don't get any choice about it. And also something called a cover charge. Well, Lord Bradford in the House of Lords at this very moment is bringing
Tony Hawk's challenge.
I think he said charge 17.5% and then cover charge, repetition of charge.
No, it's charged and charged.
Derek, you have the subject back. 13 seconds. Rackets starting now.
My goodness, you hear a terrible racket and anarchy on a Friday night. All the town is out drinking carouse. The young girls fleeing through the town in a state of absolute panic. Men clawing them from all sides. Fear strutting on their face because it's only like the charge.
My goodness, this audience obviously recognised the stubby little... recognised their own town of Anik. There we are. Derek, you were speaking as a whistle. When gained an extra point for doing so, you're equal in the lead with Peter Jones, and it's Graham Norton's turn to begin. Graham, the subject, Blarney. It's a thing that you need a great deal of in just a minute. But can you talk on the subject for just a minute, starting now?
Bigorra is a lovely example of Blarney. Though to my mind, first and foremost, Blarney is a lovely town in North Cork, not far from where my parents live, thanks for asking. And also in that place, Blarney, is Blarney Woolen Mills. And my mother's bought more than one attractive travel rug.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repeated your mother, didn't you?
Yes, she did, actually. If you mentioned Mother Thompson. 41 seconds, Derek, on Blarney, starting now.
Well, of course, at Blarney Castle...
Peter Jones' challenge.
A repetition of course. This says it quite a lot. I always write it down. I've got... sitting here.
But unfortunately, Peter, he hasn't said it in this particular round. You can repeat...
No, he's going to. You can see it.
I don't think we can have psychic challenges, actually, Peter.
Oh, well.
So it's incorrect challenge. We'll give you a bonus point because the audience enjoyed the challenge, didn't they? A bonus point to Peter, point to Derek for being interrupted. 38 seconds left on Blarney, starting now.
On the wall of Blarney Castle is a triangular stone, some 20 feet from the top. So in a typical Irish way, they reproduce at the bottom so people come along and kiss it and therefore have the gift of the Blarney, something which so many Irishmen do have.
Graham Norton challenge.
Was the repetition of Irish?
Irish man.
All right, fair enough.
Yes, yeah, I think you're right. 21 seconds. Blarney, still with you, Derek, starting now.
Eamon Andrews had it, of blessed memory. Dave Allen, of course. Gloria Hunniford.
Tony Hawks.
Repetition of course.
But unfortunately, Peter, Tony got in. You gave them the information.
Wrong with this? It's been... I think I've been nobbled.
Oh, so Tony, 16 seconds on Blarney starting now.
I kissed the Blarney stone once, but I promise it wasn't me.
Peter Jones challenge.
And obviously it doesn't hold true to what they claim.
Meaning that he's deviating because he has been touched by the Blarney stone.
He says he's been touched by it, but he hasn't got the gift of the gab or whatever it's called.
Oh, I didn't get much of a chance, did I?
No, Peter, it was a good try, but I disagree. I don't even know what the challenge was, actually, but there we are. So 13 seconds, Tony, still with you, Blarney starting now.
But I didn't get it pregnant. Cajoling tongue is what it gives you, and the ability to talk for 1 minute uninterrupted would be an example of having Blarney. Also, to pay unnecessary compliments to Nicholas...
Tony Hawks was then speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point for doing so. Peter Jones is in second place, just behind Derek Nimmo and just ahead of Tony Hawks, and then Graham Norton in that order. Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject, pottering. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
How nice it is that the end of the season in the garden, when the autumn arrives, and you've done all the work putting together the various trees that need staking back and cutting the raspberries, perhaps, and the...
Peter Jones challenge.
He seems to be hesitating a bit.
He did hesitate, yes. He thought about the raspberries and then he hesitated. He wondered whether he'd done them, I think. 47 seconds are available for you to tell us something about pottering, Peter, starting now.
Well, pottering is what people who don't like you much say you're doing when you're actually working at something comparatively useful. They kind of seem to deride any attempt at...
Derek Nimmo Chan.
Sort of hesitation.
Yeah, I thought he was running down completely, actually. He was really pottering along with very few words. 33 seconds, pottering back with you, Derek, starting now.
Down a lane in Devon, perhaps walking across a beach in Bali, up the Malaysian Peninsula, wherever you might go, there is nothing more pleasing than just to potter, not have any object in sight, just to be able to relax, commune with nature, look at old snapshots, read books, and just go pottering.
Tony Hawk's a challenge.
Repetition of just.
Yes, you did say just before. More than once, actually, yes.
Oh, once?
The idea of you wandering down a lane, reading a book, and looking at your snapshots all at the same time... It created an amazing picture in my mind. But, Tony, correct challenge. 13 seconds on pottering starting now.
When a potter gets married, he or she has to be given a ring, and this would be a potter ring. Myself, I don't hold truck with that theory. Really, pottering is going about the house, dithering around...
Tony Hawks is again speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point. He's moving forward rapidly. He's only one behind Peter Jones and only three behind our leader, Derek Nimmo. And Tony, it's your turn to begin. The subject, Heather. Will you tell us something about her, it, all that, in this game, starting now?
Heather is a small, shrub-like life form who I went out with for 2 years. Just before we split up, I wrote a love song for her called Hey, if you happen to see the most beautiful girl in the world, you won't be looking in the mirror. I cannot understand why she was not happy with me after that occasion. How I love to walk in the heather just near Annick. I walk past the Playhouse Theatre, up Bond Gate, over the River Allen, and then I find myself in this wonderful heather, and I look out and think, oh, how beautiful this world is.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of beautiful.
The beautiful heather.
Absolutely
and how beautiful
right.
The world, yes. A repetition of beautiful, and you can't say that too often about Annick, so... 25 seconds. Heather is the subject, Derek, starting now.
Heather is a small bell-like flower. Erica is the Latin name for it. And indeed, there are tremendous quantities of it in Scotland and in various parts of the world. When I'm going pottering through my garden, I particularly like to look at the heather and poke at it. This time of the year, it should be clipped from the top. And then, if it's winter variety, it'll be at its absolute peak in a month or two.
Tony Hawk's challenge.
He thinks he's on gardener's question time.
I think he was doing an audition for Gardener's Question Time, actually. But so give me a quick challenge other than your remark.
No, I didn't have one. I was trying to be humorous. I apologise.
We'll give you a bonus for trying to be humorous. And... And 6 seconds are left with Derek on Heather starting now.
I had a friend called Heather Hardy. When she married, she was called Wall, which wasn't a very good idea at all, because I thought the first name was so much nicer. When I...
Well, we're moving into the last round, and as we do so, let me tell you that Derek Nimmo is in a strong lead, but Tony Hawks is still there fighting, and so is Peter Jones, and Graham Norton is not without hope, but with only one round to go, I think he'd be hard-pressed to win unless the others help him. But, Graham, it is your turn to begin, and the subject is my favourite soap, and I'm sure you can go on that for 60 seconds with éclat starting now.
My favourite soap is mildly medicated, and that prevents me having skin fungi, which can be, you know, irritating and itchy. Though in televisual terms, my favourite soap is probably an American one called Ryan's Hope, which combined two favourite soap worlds, that of the hospital and the pub. So you had this bar opposite a big building with sick people in it, and the doctors and nurses would go into the lounge and have pints and half things of beer. And then they would go back into that thing across the road where you might hear coughing, and they would operate on people. And that's probably...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
He is deviating and quite a lot of other things as well.
Indeed he is, Peter, but as you haven't much chance of winning the show, and it's the last round, and Graham hasn't spoken as much as the rest of you, I think we'll let him continue, shall we?
No! Because he's been punished with kindness.
No! You've got 17 seconds, Graham, to continue on my favourite soap, starting now.
My favourite soap sits in a little rack by the side of my bath. It's sort of duck-shaped and metal, and it was given to me by a very jolly good chum once at Christmas many years ago. And I clean it sometimes, but not too often, because it's quite country and rustic, the way the lime scaly water drips on it and collects there.
So, as I said before, that was to be the last round, so let me give you the final score. Graham Norton was keep going until the whistle went, then gained an extra point, and for the first time player of the game, I thought he did magnificently. Yeah. He finished in fourth place. Contributed well. He was just behind Peter Jones, who was just behind Tony Hawks, but a little way out in the lead was Derek Nimmo, so we say that, Derek, you are the winner this week. Remains for me to thank our four outstanding players of the game, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, Tony Hawks and Graham Norton. Also to thank Yolanta Zubuki, who's been keeping the score so well and blowing the whistle with some effect, and also Ian Messiter, who created the game and keeps us all in work, our producer Anne Jobson. And let me say from all of us here, goodbye, and hope you'll be with us next time we play Just a Minute. Thank you.